Hello, dear students. We'll continue our lecture. In the previous lecture, we discussed about the definition of bone and the classification of bones. And we discussed about the types of bones, blood supply of long bone, and also we discussed about a little bit about ossification. Now let us see the microscopic structure of bone. So mainly we focus on what type of cells are present in the bone. I have already told you that bone is a specialized connective tissue. So it consists of cells. What are those cells in the bone? So we have number one, osteoblasts. So these osteoblast cells, they are derived from osteoprogenitor cells. So which are located in the mesenchyme, that is embryonic connective tissue, or in the periosteum, or in the endosteum. So these osteoblasts, they secrete a material which is known as osteoid. So which is a matrix consists of proteoglycans and glycoproteins, and also the type 1 collagen fibers. So these cells, the osteoblasts, they undergo mitosis, and they are the precursor cells of the osteocytes. So this is about the osteoblast cells. Next we have the osteocytes. The osteocytes, they are derived from osteoblasts. So once osteoblast becomes surrounded by matrix, so it becomes a osteocyte. So these osteocytes, they are flattened cells with numerous cytoplasmic processes. As you can see in this picture, there are numerous cytoplasmic processes of the osteocyte. So they are located in the spaces of the matrix known as the lacunae and canaliculi respectively. If you see the microscopic structure of bone, they are located in the spaces known as the lacunae and also the canaliculi. So the osteocytes, they do not undergo mitosis, whereas the osteoblast, they undergo mitosis. Now the canaliculi, which radiate from each lacuna, they permit fusion of nutritive material. This is very, very important. The canaliculi which radiate from each lacunae or the space of the osteocyte, they are helpful for the transport of or diffusion of nutritive material. So next we have another type of cell, the osteoclasts. So these osteoclasts, they are derived from the fusion of uncommitted cells of the red bone marrow. Which are related to a type of white blood cell known as the monocyte. So they are large cells with multiple nuclei, as you can see in this picture. So these osteoclast cells, they help in resorption of bone and play an important role in bone remodeling. So they help in resorption of bone. So what do you mean by resorption of bone tissue? So that process by which osteoclasts break down the tissue in bones and release minerals. So that results in transfer of calcium from bone to the blood. So that is the function of these osteoclast cells. They are multinucleated and very large cells. And these osteoclasts, they reside in a shallow depression of the bone known as Hauschupp's lacunae, Howship, Hauschupp's lacunae. Lacunae means space. So they reside in a shallow depression of the bone known as the Hauschupp's lacunae. And these cells also do not undergo in mitosis. Okay, so these are the three kinds of bone cells which you have to remember: the osteoblast cells, the osteocytes, and osteoclast cells. Dear students, let us discuss about ossification of long bone in detail. So, ossification of a long bone is nothing but the intracartilaginous ossification. Okay, intracartilaginous ossification. Why I am saying intracartilaginous ossification? Because they develop from cartilage, especially the long bones of the limbs. They are ossified from intracartilaginous ossification. All the long bones of the limbs, both the upper limb and the lower limb, they are ossified by intracartilaginous ossification. So what is the first step? If you see in the ossification of a long bone, first the bone is laid as hyaline cartilaginous model. So this is completely a cartilaginous model of a bone. As you can see, this is a complete cartilaginous model of the bone, surrounded by perichondrium, we say perichondrium, because hyaline cartilage, you will learn in connective tissue that it is surrounded by a layer which is known as the perichondrium. So then in the step 2, we have the primary ossification center, right? The primary ossification center. So what is this primary ossification center? It appears in the center of the shaft of the bone. So as you can see in this diagram, the primary ossification center, it appears in the center of the shaft of a bone, and it spreads towards the ends to form the diaphysis. Okay, so it spreads towards the ends to form diaphysis. So this is the primary ossification center. So where it appears? It appears in the middle of the shaft of a long bone, then it spreads towards the ends of a bone to form the complete diaphysis. The step 3 includes the lay down of periosteum, right? The periosteum appears, you can see here, which is known as a periosteal collar, we say. Okay, so you see a formation of primary center of ossification. At the same time, you also see a periosteal collar, okay, around the circumference of the shaft. So periosteal collar around the shaft, and also the primary ossification center in the middle of the shaft, they appear at the same time. Then later, if you see, the secondary centers of ossification develop at each end of the bone. As you can see, this is the upper end and this is the lower end. So each end of the bone, you see the appearance of the secondary centers of the ossification. Okay, these are the secondary centers of the ossification. Then you see in another step the epiphyseal cartilage. The epiphyseal cartilage, it separates epiphysis from the diaphysis. The epiphyseal cartilage, it separates epiphysis from the diaphysis. So demarcation between the epiphysis and the diaphysis is epiphyseal cartilage. Okay, so it remains cartilaginous. The epiphyseal cartilage at each end of the bone, you can see here, this is also epiphyseal cartilage and this is also epiphyseal cartilage. So at the ends of the bone, it is remain cartilaginous. Now this epiphyseal plate of cartilage continue to produce new cartilage, so it enables the bone growth in length. So that is a function of epiphyseal plate of cartilage. So it continue to produce new cartilage, which enables bone to grow in length. So for this reason also, this epiphyseal plate of the cartilage is known as the growth plate. It is a growth plate of the bone. So once the growth in length is completed, the remaining epiphyseal cartilage ceases to proliferate and becomes ossified. So this epiphyseal plate of cartilage also becomes ossified. That means it becomes bone. And it leaving a scar, you can see here, this is known as epiphyseal line. Epiphyseal line, or you can say epiphyseal plate. So that is a function of the epiphyseal plate of cartilage. Okay, so it grows the bone in length, right? And once the growth of the bone is completed, so it becomes a scar, which is known as the epiphyseal line. So what are these ossification centers? I told you the primary ossification center and secondary ossification center. The primary ossification center, it appears before birth. Pay attention. Primary ossification center, they appear before birth. That means when the baby is in the mother's womb, usually between 7th to 12th week of intrauterine life. Okay? Whereas the secondary ossification centers, they appear as a rule after birth. The secondary ossification centers, they appear after birth. So usually from the time of birth to 5 years of age. Okay. So a primary center of ossification, it forms diaphysis. And secondary centers of ossification, they form epiphysis. So the fusion of epiphysis with the diaphysis starts at puberty and usually completed by the age of 25 years. So therefore, after the age of 25 years, no more bone growth take place. Okay, so this is about the ossification centers and ossification of long bone. Still further, if you have any clarification, you can ask me. Okay, so you should know what is primary ossification center, when it appears, and you should know what is secondary ossification center and when it appears. Okay, so one thing you should remember here, all the secondary centers, they appear after birth. But there is an exception, one at the lower end of the femur, which appears in the 9th month of intrauterine life. So generally, secondary centers of ossification, they appear after birth. But there is an exception for the lower end of the femur, a bone which is present in the lower limb, for which the secondary ossification center appears in the 9th month of intrauterine life, okay, and sometimes at the upper end of the tibia and humerus also. So this you have to remember. Okay, so what is this, why we are studying about ossification and this primary and secondary ossification, what clinical correlation it has? See, the visibility of center of ossification in the distal end of femur. So secondary center of ossification for the femur, it appears in the 9th month of intrauterine life. So when the visibility of the center of ossification in the distal end of the femur in the radiograph of a newborn child who found dead is of medico-legal importance, because it indicates that the child was full term. Okay, so in X-ray of newborns, the shaft of long bone represents a white radio opaque shadow, whereas ends and joints, they represent the present radiolucent shadow. So this is because at birth the shaft of the cartilaginous model is ossified. Okay, why? Because the shaft is developing from the primary center. So whereas the secondary center for the lower end of the femur, it appears at 9th month of intrauterine life. That means if the child found dead and you see the secondary center of ossification at the lower end of the femur in an X-ray, that means it indicates that the child was full term. Okay, so this you have to remember. So this has got a medico-legal importance. Okay, then, so this is about the clinical correlation. Sometimes they ask you regarding the lower end of the femur, that it has a medico-legal importance, right? So we can detect in the X-ray, like if the secondary center of ossification is present, that means the child was a full term. Okay, so this is about the primary and the secondary ossification centers and ossification of the long bone. Dear students, let us understand the growing end of a long bone. See, in most of the long bones, like an example we take here, the humerus, femur, tibia, radius and ulna, all these are the long bones. Two epiphyses do not fuse simultaneously. Okay, so in most of the long bones, the two epiphyses do not fuse simultaneously. The epiphyses at one end, let's say this epiphysis at one end, always fuses few years before than that of the other end. Okay, that you have to remember. So the end at which fusion occurs later, that end is known as the growing end of the long bone. The growing end of the long bone. So, and this is also the end at which secondary center of ossification appears first. So what is growing end of the long bone? The end which fusion occurs later, is called the growing end of a lung. So the growing end, it is located opposite the direction of nutrient foramen. Now the direction of nutrient foramen, it is easily remembered by a dictum here. It is written here, to the elbow I go, from knee I flee. Right? So thus, the upper limb, shoulder and humerus and the wrist ends of the ulna, the knees, the knee ends of the femur, tibia and fibula are the growing ends. So what are the growing ends? In the upper limb, the shoulder and the humerus and wrist ends of the radius and ulna, and in the lower limb, the knee ends of the femur and tibia and fibula are the growing ends. So these are the growing ends in the upper limb and in the lower limb. So what is the law of union of epiphyses? Law of union of epiphyses, or you can say law of ossification, it is very, very important. Now according to this law, the epiphyseal center, that means the secondary center of ossification, which appears first, unites last, and the epiphyseal center which appears later, it unites first. Okay, that is actually the law of union of epiphyses. So according to epiphyseal law, the center, that means the secondary center of ossification, which appears first, we are talking only about the secondary center here, okay, not the primary center. The secondary center of ossification which appears first unites at the end, and the epiphyseal center which appears later unites first. There is an exception in case of fibula, where epiphyseal center for the lower end appears first and also unites first. That is in case of fibula. On the other hand, epiphyseal center for the upper end appears late and also unites late. Thus, fibula is the only lung bone which violates the law of union of epiphyses. So once again I repeat, the law of union of epiphyses states that the secondary center of ossification which appears first, it unites last. Okay, and the epiphyseal center of ossification which appears later, it unites first. So there is an exception for the fibula, where the epiphyseal center for the lower end of the fibula appears first and also unites first, and on the other hand, epiphyseal center for the upper end appears late and also unites late. The fibula is the only lung bone which is violating the law of union of epiphyses. Hope you have understood this. Let us discuss about the next chapter, joints. See, in general usage, what is the meaning of joint? It means a place where two things are joined together. Okay, in general usage we say, where two things are joined together. But in anatomy, joint is a junction between two or more bones. Okay, so joint is a junction between two or more bones. Let us discuss about the introduction of joints. Joint or articulation. Articulation is nothing but a joint. Okay, it is a junction between two or more bones. Okay, with the exception of the hyoid bone, every bone in the body is connected to or forms a joint. Okay, so exception is there for the hyoid bone, which is located below the mandible. So there are approximately about 230 joints in our body. Okay, so the term articulation refers to a joint, and the term arthrology means study of joints. Okay, then from arthrology we have one more term, arthritis, inflammation of a joint. Okay, so what is a joint? It is a device to permit movements. Okay, that is the function of joint. It is a device to permit movements. Now, some joints are immovable. We will discuss in detail. Okay. Now, so definition of a joint again, we repeat. A joint is the location at which two or more bones make contact. Okay, they are constructed to allow movement and provide mechanical support, and are classified structurally and functionally. We will see the structural classification and functional classification of joints. Structural classification is determined by how the bones connect to each other, while the functional classification is determined by degree of movement between the articulating bones. So based on the degree of movement between the articulating bones is functional classification. And based on how the bones are connected to each other, that will tell us about the structural classification of a joint. So structural classification and functional classification. So functions of joints: they hold the skeletal bones together and they allow the skeleton some flexibility so gross movements can occur, and they also make bone growth possible. Coming to the classification of joints, in the previous slide I told you that the joints can be classified according to their structure and function. Okay, we will see both the structural classification and the functional classification of a joint. Now, structural classification of joint. So it is based upon the connecting tissue and the presence or absence of joint cavity. The structural classification, it is based upon the connecting tissue and the presence or absence of a joint cavity. They are classified into three types: fibrous joints, cartilaginous joints, and synovial. Okay, so fibrous joints, here the bones forming the joint are united by a fibrous connective tissue. That's why they are known as fibrous joints. So fibrous joints, here the bones forming the joint are united by fibrous tissue. So these joints are either immovable or permit only a slight degree of movement. Remember, these fixed means they are immovable, or they permit only a slight degree of movement. And a fibrous joint, it lacks joint cavity. Okay, it does not have a joint cavity. So in the fibrous joints, again we have three types: the sutures, the syndesmosis, and gomphosis. Okay, these are the three types in the fibrous joints: sutures, syndesmosis, and gomphosis. So what are these sutures? Okay, the articular surfaces are connected by thin layer of connective tissue. I will show you the picture also. The sutures, the articular surfaces are connected by thin layer of connective tissue, which are known as the suture ligaments. Okay, these joints are present in the skull. Okay, they are peculiar to the skull. Sutures are peculiar to the skull because you find many sutures in the skull, over the surface of the skull and also inside the skull. So and they are immovable. Okay, the sutures which are found on the skull, they are immovable. In growing children, they may permit little mobility. So depending upon the shape of the articular surface and margins of the articulated bones, these joints further, these sutures are further divided into plane suture, the squamous suture, the serrate or limbus suture, then we have dentate suture or denticulate suture, then we have syndylesis. So what do you mean by plane suture? Here the articulating surfaces are plane, they are fairly smooth. Example is median palatine suture. Median palatine suture, this is at the roof of the hard palate where the paid maxillary and palatine bones articulate to form the hard palate. So in the hard palate you can make out the plane suture, that means the roof of the oral cavity. There you have hard palate and there you can make out the plane suture. Then we have the squamous suture. The squamous suture is articulating surfaces of the suture are relatively flat and they overlap each other. This is example between the temporal and the parietal bones, the temporal and the parietal bones of the skull. Then we have serrate suture. The articular surfaces of the suture are reciprocally serrated and interlock with each other in a jigsaw fashion. Okay, so example is the sagittal suture. The sagittal suture, it is present over the vault of the skull. Then we have denticulate suture. The margins of the sutures interlock with each other like teeth of a saw, because the name itself tells you, dentate, denticulate suture, means the sutures interlock with each other like a teeth of saw. Example is lambdoid suture. Again, the lambdoid suture, it is present at the occipital bone between the parietal and the occipital bones of the skull. Okay, these sutures will be shown when you come to the dissection hall. Okay, but try to see the images. I will also show you the images in the PowerPoint. Okay, but when you come to dissection hall, we will show you all the practicals. Then the last one we have syndylesis. It is a specialized suture where a ridge of one bone fits into a groove of the other bone. That is actually a joint. Example is the joint between the rostrum of the sphenoid bone and cleft between the alae of the vomer bone. That is the example of syndylesis. Okay, so this is about the fibrous joint. Again, it is classified into sutures, gomphosis and syndesmosis. So among the sutures we have plane, squamous, serrate, dentate and syndylesis. Okay, next we will move on to the gomphosis. Gomphosis is nothing but we say peg and socket joint. Okay, so these are specialized fibrous joints and they are restricted to the fixation of teeth in the alveolar socket. So all the teeth are fixed in the alveolar socket of the mandible. So the maxillae and the maxillae. So the root of the tooth is attached to the socket within the alveolus by periodontal ligament. The root of the tooth, it is attached within the socket of the alveolus by periodontal ligament. So that is gomphosis. So gomphosis, it is confined only to the teeth. Okay, this is also known as peg and socket joint, PEG, peg and socket joint. Then we have syndesmosis. The syndesmosis, these are the joints where two adjacent bones are interlinked together with greater amount of connective tissue. Right? So we have example is intraosseous radioulnar joints and intraosseous tibiofibular joint and inferior tibiofibular joint. So they are the joints between adjacent laminae of the vertebrae. So they are connected by various ligaments. Okay. So syndesmosis, what do you mean by syndesmosis? These joints where the two adjacent bones are linked by considerably a greater amount of connective tissue. Example is tibiofibular, radioulnar and inferior tibiofibular joints. So this is about the fibrous joints in detail. Okay. In this slide, we can make out the examples of fibrous joints. So you can see here the plane suture joint, right? The plane suture, what did I tell you in the previous slide? The articular surfaces are plane and they are fairly smooth, right? We can see the sutural ligament or the sutural membrane in between. Okay, this is an example of plane suture. So median palatine suture, right? And you have maxillary and palatine bones articulate to form hard palate. So those are the sutures which are the examples of this plane suture. Then we have serrate suture. Here you can see example is interparietal suture. Example is interparietal suture. So the articular surfaces here, they are serrated, reciprocally serrated and interlock with each other in a jigsaw fashion. Example is the sagittal suture, you can see, or interparietal suture. Then we have the squamous suture. So the articulating surface, they overlap each other. So example is between the temporal and the parietal bone, right? Then we have the denticulate suture. The margins of the suture interlock with each other like teeth of a saw. Example is lambdoid suture, we can see here, right? Then we have the shin dialysis. It is a specialized suture, right, where the ridge of one bone fits into a groove of the other bone. So example is joint between the rostrum of sphenoid bone and cleft between the alae of the vomer, the alae of the vomer bone, right? Then we have, this is syndesmosis, that we can see the interosseous membrane between the tibia and the fibula, right? This is an example of the gomphosis, right? Which is an example of the fibrous joint, right? And it is a peg and socket joint. So these, about these different types of sutures we have discussed in the previous slide, and these are the examples. In the exam you have to draw the diagram if they ask you. Dear students, so far we have discussed about the fibrous joints, which we classify under the structural classification of joint. Now this is the second type of joint under structural classification, that is cartilaginous joint. Okay, the cartilaginous joints are those joints in which the bones forming the joint are united by means of the cartilage. Okay, either the hyaline cartilage or fibrocartilage. So bones forming the joint are united by means of hyaline cartilage or the fibrocartilage. See, you will understand about hyaline cartilage and fibrous cartilage in detail in further classes of the histology or the general anatomy. Okay, for time being you remember that the cartilaginous joints, because the name itself, it tells you that the bones are united by means of the hyaline cartilage or the fibrous cartilage. So and the cartilage, this cartilage, cartilaginous joint also lack the joint cavity. Okay, so next we will discuss about the types of cartilaginous joints. The cartilaginous joints have been classified into two types: primary cartilaginous joint and secondary cartilaginous joint. So what is primary cartilaginous joint? The primary cartilaginous joint, also known as the synchondrosis, right? The primary cartilaginous joints, also known as the synchondrosis. The bones are part of the bones forming the joint are united by a plate of hyaline cartilage. A plate of hyaline cartilage. So you can see here the example of the primary cartilaginous joint. First costosternal joint. Here you can see the first costosternal joint. Costo means rib, sterno means sternum, and between this you have a plate of hyaline cartilage. So this is first costosternal joint, is an example of primary cartilaginous joint. And also the other example is joint between the epiphysis and diaphysis of a growing long bone, which we have discussed in the previous slides. So that is also an example of primary cartilaginous joint, right? And the joint between the base sphenoid and base occiput, these are the three examples of the primary cartilaginous joints. So here the bones are united by means of a plate of hyaline cartilage, we say. So these joints are immovable and mostly temporary in nature. So this cartilage may ossify with age. So this cartilage may become bone by age. So what are the examples of primary cartilaginous joints? Number one, the joint between the epiphysis and the diaphysis of a long bone. First, costosternal joint. Then the joint between the base sphenoid or base occiput, that is sphenooccipital joint of the skull. Okay, so this is about the primary cartilaginous joints. Next, see, we can see here, I have already told you the examples here. This is the epiphyseal plate of hyaline cartilage, is an example of the primary cartilaginous joint, and the first costosternal joint. Then the secondary cartilaginous joint. The secondary cartilaginous joint, also known as symphysis. Symphysis. S-Y-M-P-H-Y-S-E-S. Symphysis. So in these joints, so the articular surfaces of bone forming the joint are covered by a plates of hyaline cartilage. You can make out here. So the secondary cartilaginous joints are covered by a plane of plates of hyaline cartilage, which are connected by a disc of fibrocartilage, a disc or a pad of fibrocartilage. So bones are united by a plate of hyaline cartilage, which are connected by a disc of fibrocartilaginous fibrocartilage. Okay, example is the symphysis pubis, that is joint between the symphysis pubis, the joint between the two pubic bones. Okay, then intervertebral disc between the bodies of the adjacent vertebra. Then manubriosternal joint between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. We will show you, once you come to dissection hall, I will show you what is in the bones. We can appreciate the symphysis pubis, and between the adjacent vertebra, intervertebral disc, it is a secondary cartilaginous joints, and manubriosternal joint between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. Then the symphysis menti between the two halves of the fetal mandible. So these are the examples of secondary cartilaginous joint. That means all these joints are in the midline. Symphysis pubis in the midline of the body, intervertebral disc is in the midline of the body, and manubriosternal joint is also midline of the body. So this is about the secondary cartilaginous joints. So what are secondary cartilaginous joints? The articular surfaces of bones forming the joint are covered by thin plate of hyaline cartilage, which are connected by a disc of fibrocartilage. Okay. Let us discuss about synovial joints. These are very, very important from examination point of view. So under structural classification of joints, we have discussed about the fibrous joints, number one. Number two, we discussed about cartilaginous joints. Now the last one is the synovial joint. So these synovial joints are freely movable joints. Okay, so they are also known as diarthrodial joints. Okay, synovial joints are also known as diarthrodial joints. Okay, now these joints, they possess a cavity and the articular ends of bones forming the joint are enclosed in a fibrous capsule. So as a result, they are separated by a narrow cavity, which is known as the articular cavity, and it is filled with a fluid known as the synovial fluid. So the synovial fluid is like an egg albumin, hence the name the synovial joint. Let us discuss about the characteristic features of synovial joint. Number one, the articular surfaces are covered by a thin plate of hyaline cartilage. So the articular surfaces of the bone, they are covered by a thin plate of hyaline cartilage. Okay, number two, the joint cavity is enveloped by an articular capsule. Okay, you can see here, this is the articular capsule. The joint cavity, it is enveloped by a capsule, which is known as the articular capsule, which consists of outer fibrous, this is the fibrous capsule, and inner lining is known as the synovial membrane, inner synovial membrane. The joint cavity is lined everywhere by synovial membrane except over the articular cartilage. Okay, the cavity is filled with synovial fluid secreted by synovial membrane. The joint cavity is filled with synovial fluid secreted by synovial membrane, and it provides nutrition to the articular cartilage and lubrication of the articular surfaces of the bone. Some joint cavity completely or incompletely divided by an articular disc or the menisci. So menisci usually you see at the knee joint, and articular disc you see at the temporomandibular joint. Okay. Let us discuss about the classification of synovial joints. Okay, according to the shape of the articular surfaces, the synovial joints have been classified into 7 types. There are 7 types of synovial joints according to the shape of articular surfaces. Number 1, plane joint. Number 2, hinge joint. Number 3, pivot joint. Number 4, condylar joint. Number 5, ellipsoid joint. Number 6, saddle joint. And number 7, ball and socket joint. So you should know about each and every joint, and you should give examples for these type of joints. Okay, so this is according to the shape of the articular surfaces. There are 7 types of synovial joints: plane, hinge, pivot, condylar, ellipsoid, saddle joint, ball and socket joint. Now we shall discuss about briefly about each and every type of the synovial joints under the shape of the articular surfaces. Number 1, plane joint. Now the articular surfaces, they are nearly flat, okay, more or less flat. So they permit gliding movements in various directions like side to side movements, back and forth movements, and with slight rotation also possible at the plane synovial joint. Okay, so they perform simple movements. Okay, you have to remember this. So what are the examples where these plane joints are located in the body? Number one, we have intercarpal joint, that is between the carpal bones of the hands, intertarsal joints between the tarsal bones of the foot, then joints between the articular process of the adjacent vertebra. Okay, then we have intermetacarpal joint. So these are the few examples of plane synovial joint. So you can see here, these are examples of plane synovial joint, intercarpal joint, right? Then intermetacarpal joints here you can see, right? So these are the few examples of plane synovial joint. Next variety we have the hinge variety, hinge joint. So the articular surfaces are pulley shaped. The articular surfaces are pulley shaped. So movements are permitted only in one plane. Movements are permitted only in one plane around transverse axis. So this movement consists of a flexion and extension, that is at the elbow. Okay, so the movement takes place only in one plane around transverse axis. So these joints have strong collateral ligaments, that you should remember. So these joints have strong collateral ligaments to prevent other movements. Okay, so what are the examples? Number one, you have elbow joint, where flexion extension is possible. So the movement is permitted only in one plane around the transverse axis. So example is the elbow joint, where flexion and extension takes place. Then interphalangeal joint. Interphalangeal joints, that is in the phalanges are in the fingers. Then knee joint, and also an ankle joint. So examples are very, very important, you have to remember. So hinge joint, the examples of hinge joint is elbow joint, knee joint, interphalangeal joint, and an ankle joint. Next, we can see here, the articular surfaces are pulley shaped in case of hinge joint. Okay, movement is possible only in one plane around transverse axis. Then next, coming to the other variety, pivot joint. The articular surfaces of one bone is rounded and fits into a concavity of another bone. Okay, the articular surfaces of one bone is rounded, as you can see here, this articular surface is rounded. This is the radius bone, okay, of the forearm. So further rounded part is surrounded by ligamentous ring. So movement is limited to the rotation around the central axis. So movement is limited around the central axis. Around the central axis. So example is this type of joint, the joints between the proximal ends of the radius and ulna. So we can make out this is the radius and this is ulna. So proximal ends of the radius and ulna, and the atlantoaxial joint. Atlas is the first cervical bone and axis is the second cervical bone at the neck region. So atlantoaxial joint is also an example of pivot joint. So what are pivot joints? So pivot joints are articular surfaces of one bone is rounded, fits into the concavity of another bone. So further the rounded part is surrounded by a ligamentous ring. Okay, so the movement in a pivot joint has limited rotation around central axis. That means either the rod rotates in osteoligamentous ring, as in case of example is superior radio ulnar joint, right? The superior radio ulnar joint permits rotation of the forearm, and median atlanto-axial joint allows the rotation of the head. So this median atlanto-axial joint allows rotation of the head, and superior radio ulnar joint, as you can see here, this allows the rotation of the hand. So superior radio ulnar joint permits rotation of the forearm. So we can see, this is actually the superior radio ulnar joint. You can see that the articular surface, it is surrounded by a ligamentous ring. So within this, the movement takes place. Okay. So the superior radio ulnar joint permits the rotation of the forearm. Next, coming to the fourth variety, the condylar joint. The round articular surface of one bone fits into the socket of articular surface of another bone. So this is the round articular surface. It fits into the socket type of articular surface of the another bone. The end of the bone bearing round articular surface is called the condyle. So as in case of, this is temporomandibular joint. So you can see this is the condylar process of the mandible, and you above you find a cavity. So this condylar process fits into the cavity. So these joint permit movements in two directions. Example, the right and left temporomandibular joints, as well as the knee joint. Okay. So the round articular surface of one socket fits into the round articular surface of one bone fits into socket type of articular surface of the another bone. Okay. So this you have to remember. So these joints permit movements in two directions. So we say biaxial movement, biaxial, okay, up and down and side to side movements. Okay. So right and left temporomandibular joint, and also the knee joint. Next we have ellipsoid joint. The elliptical convex surface of one bone articulates with the elliptical concave surface of another bone. The movements are permitted in two directions. Example, this is also a biaxial joint. Example, the flexion and extension around transverse axis. So what are the examples? You have wrist joint, atlanto-occipital joint, metacarpophalangeal joint, and metatarsophalangeal joints. So what you have to remember here, so the movements are permitted in two directions. We say biaxial. That means at wrist joint, flexion extension is possible, right? Atlanto-occipital joint also flexion extension is possible, right? They occur in on transverse axis. And abduction, adduction. Abduction is movement away from the median plane. Adduction is movement towards the median plane. So adduction and abduction is also possible at the wrist joint, right? And around anteroposterior. So this adduction and abduction occurs at anteroposterior axis. So combination of these movements produces circumduction. So circumduction also possible at the ellipsoid joint. Combination of flexion, extension, abduction and adduction is known as circumduction. So example is the wrist joint, we say atlanto-occipital joint, and also the metacarpophalangeal joint and metatarsophalangeal joint. So this is biaxial joint. We say elliptical convex surface of one bone articulates with the elliptical concave surface of the other bone. Radiocarpal, atlanto-occipital, metatarsophalangeal, and so these are the examples of, basically these are the examples of ellipsoid joint. Next we have saddle variety. Saddle joint or the sellar joint, we say the articular surfaces are saddle in shape. Saddle, you know, there is actually where we sit on a horse. So the horse, it on its back, it has a saddle. So the shape exactly, the shape of the joint is exactly like a saddle. So the articular surfaces are reciprocally saddle shaped, that is concave or convex. This unique articulation is modified condyloid joint that allows a wide range of movement. Okay, an example would be the joint between trapezium and metacarpal bones of the thumb sternoclavicular joint. So the articular surfaces are saddle shaped. Means saddle shaped means they are concavo convex. So this is actually a unique articulation, right? So examples we can give: first, carpo metacarpal joint, right? That is a joint of the thumb. Then we have sternoclavicular joint, right? Then calcaneo cuboid joint and incudo malleolar joint in the middle ear. Incudo joint between the incus and the malleus of the middle ear. So middle ear has three bones, right? Malleus, incus and stapes. So incudo malleolar joint is also a saddle type of joint, right, which is present in the middle ear. Coming to the last variety, ball and socket joint, also known as the spheroidal joint. So ball and socket consists of a bone with ball shaped head. You can see here a bone with ball shaped head, like this is in case of femur, we have rounded head, that attaches with cup shaped cavity of another bone. So there is a cavity here, this is acetabulum, actually cup shaped cavity. So it fits into the cup shaped cavity of another bone. This type of joint allows a wider range of motion than any other kind. Okay, it permits movements in all planes and a rotational movement around central axis. Two examples this type of joint would be the hip joint and the shoulder joint, and also the incudo-stapedial joint. Okay, so ball and socket joint, where you can perform a wide range of movements. Okay, so the movements would be like, if you take shoulder, imagine the Kapil Dev, the fastest bowler of India. So the shoulder joint, if you imagine his shoulder joint, where the flexion is possible, extension is possible, adduction is possible, abduction is possible, medial rotation is possible, lateral rotation is possible, and circumduction is also possible at these ball and socket variety of joints. Examples would be hip joint, shoulder joint and incudo-stapedial joint of the middle ear. Okay, so this is about classification of synovial joints according to the shape of the articular surfaces. These are very, very important, and you have to remember all these seven types. Number one, plain synovial joint. Number two, hinge synovial joint. Number three, pivot. Number four, the condylar joint. Number fifth, ellipsoid joint. Number sixth, saddle type of joint. And number seventh, ball and socket are the spheroidal joint. So for each joint, you have to describe the articular surfaces and you should give the examples for this. Now coming to the functional classification of the joint, this is based on the degree of mobility, right? Degree of mobility. We classified the joint into three types: synarthrosis, amphiarthrosis, diarthrosis. Diarthrosis, already I told you, the diarthrosis is nothing but the synovial joints. So they are freely movable joints, that you should remember. Number one, synarthrosis. Synarthrosis, they are immovable, like fibrous joints. Synarthrosis permit little or no mobility, as most synarthrosis joints are fibrous joint. Example, cranial sutures in adult. Next, functional classification under the second is amphiarthrosis, where they are slightly movable joints, like cartilaginous. Amphiarthrosis permits slight mobility. The two bone surfaces at joint are both covered by hyaline cartilage and joined by strands of fibrocartilage. Example is secondary cartilaginous joints. So what are the examples of secondary cartilaginous joints? All midline joints are secondary cartilaginous joints. Diarthrosis permit variety of movements only. The synovial joints are diarthrodial, which we have discussed in detail. Synovial joints are very, very important. All those seven types of synovial joints you have to memorize, okay, and practice the diagrams for each of the type of synovial joint. Classification of according to the number of articulating bones. We say simple joint, compound joint and complex joint. Simple means two articulation surfaces we have. Example, shoulder joint and hip joint. Then compound, three or more articulating surfaces. Example is radiocarpal joint, and complex means three or more articulation surfaces and an articular disc or meniscus. Example is knee joint. This is based on number of articulating ones. Simple, compound, complex. Terms relating to the joint movements, we have extension, hyperextension, flexion, plantar flexion, dorsiflexion, abduction, adduction, circumduction. Already extension, increasing the angle is known as extension. Hyperextension means to increase angle beyond the anatomical position. Flexion is decreasing the angle, as in case of elbow. Plantar flexion to the point to the toe. Dorsiflexion pulls the toes up. Abduction, moving the limb away from the trunk or the body. Adduction means moving the limb towards the body. Adduction, moving the limbs towards the trunk of the body. Rotation, movements of the bone around an axis. Circumduction, circular movement of the distal end of the limb. Supination, the palm of the anatomical position, the palm face forward. Okay, that is supination. Pronation, palm face backwards. Okay, inversion, turning the sole of the foot inward, that is called inversion. Eversion, turning the sole of the foot outward, is known as eversion. Parts of a joint. I have already told you that it has a fibrous capsule, reinforcing ligaments, synovial membrane, articular cartilage, articular disc, fatty pads, or bursae. Bursae are flattened sacs that contain synovial fluid. And what is their function? They reduce the friction between the bones. Okay, this you remember. Bursae, they are flattened sacs. They are filled with synovial fluid and they prevent the friction among the bones. Okay, these are the parts of a joint. So we can make out all the parts of the joint in these diagrams. Okay. Factors influencing the joint stability: the bones, ligaments, and the muscles. Now coming to the blood supply of synovial joint. They are derived from periarticular network of arteries that surround the joint. Periarticular, on either side of the joint, the blood is blood supply is derived from there. This network is formed from the branches of arteries lying close to the joint, vicinity of the joint. It supplies the capsule, synovial membrane, and epiphysis. Nerve supply of the synovial joint: sensory nerve fibers carrying pain, sensory nerve fibers conveying proprioceptive sensation. Okay. Touch, pain, temperature. Autonomic fibers have vasomotor effect. Capsule is innervated by raphenous corpus cell and free nerve endings. Okay, this you will understand in physiology. Synovial membrane is innervated by vasomotor sympathetic fibers. You will come to know this in the sympathetic fibers and the nerve endings and about the proprioceptive sensation. All these you will come to know in general anatomy of the nervous system. For time being, you have to memorize these terms. What is the nerve supply to a joint? This is very, very important. It comes with very short notes in the exam. Hilton's law. The nerve supplying the joint capsule. Let's say this is a capsule. So the nerve which is supplying this joint capsule also supply the muscles, regulating the movement of the joint, and skin over the joint. So muscles which are regulating the movement of the joint and skin over the joint are supplied by the same nerve. That is known as the Hilton's law. Clinical anatomy: sciatica. If the disc prolapse occurs in lumbar or sacral nerves, there is a radiating pain in the lower limb. The rheumatic fever. Then we have rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis. Degenerative changes in spondylitis may occur in the cervical spine, leading to narrow intervertebral foramen, causing pressure on spinal nerve. So thank you very much, students. So if you have any clarifications, you can directly text me. Okay, and joint chapter is very, very important. So most of the topics I have covered. So among the joint, the synovial joints are very, very important. Okay, so go through the chapter, practice the diagrams. Thank you very much.